Good morning, 11 o'clock church. So glad you could be with us this morning as we celebrate and worship our great God. Let's all stand together and sing how great God is, and He is for us. That's good news.
Strong and mighty fortress, raise your voice now. No love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Sing with joy now. Our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now. No love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God?
Good morning. Hello, I'm Mark Groman.
And I'm Christiana Pagel Olden.
This is my fiance. We've been part of the Gitmo family for about 3 years now. I work at the power plant for Siemens, and she is a wonderful kindergarten teacher at W.T. Sampson. We wanted to talk about one of our favorite Christmas traditions, and it's not putting up the Christmas tree before Thanksgiving.
Today, we light the second candle of Advent, the candle of faith. Christ was born just as God had promised. God's people in other times waited and trusted in that promise. Our hope is in Christ, who comes into our hearts and promises to return. The candle of hope, which is already lit, reminds us of that. Today, we light a new candle, the candle of faith to remind us that we can trust the God who keeps his word.
Today we read Romans 10, 13 through 17. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. But how can they call on him to save them unless they believe in him? And how can they believe in him if they've never heard about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone tells them? And how will anyone go and tell them without being sent? This is why the scriptures say, how beautiful are the feet of messengers who bring good news. But not everyone welcomes the good news, for Isaiah the prophet said, Lord, who has believed our message? So faith comes from hearing. That is the good news about Christ. So let us pray. Father, we have heard enough to believe. Help us not to hear only, but to trust. You have said we can live forever by trusting you. Like so many before us, we believe in Jesus Christ. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, amen.
Amen. As we light this candle of faith, we join with those saints who've gone before us, even in the Old Testament, who believed the promises of God, anticipated the coming Messiah. They knew that not only was God for them, but God would be with them, and they cried out, Emmanuel, O God, be with us. And so as we stand and sing these next songs, we anticipate the coming of Emmanuel. Our God is with us. Let's stand and sing, O come, Emmanuel, our long-expected Jesus.
To thee, O Israel.
Amen. Well, you may have a seat as we continue in worship. You know, one of the aspects that we get to do as church, and I'm actually excited about this morning, there's multiple things that just remind us that when we gather together as the church, this is a sacred event. And this is a wonderful family moment, and whether it's lighting the Advent candle or some of the things we're going to take place a little farther in the service, or certainly the communion table. And when we come to the communion table, it is never just another moment that we do as a just simply a tradition. This is a sacrament that was left to us. This is an opportunity that was given to us by the Lord as an opportunity to not just go through the motions, but be reminded of what it is that we are doing when we come together in this way. And the Lord knew how important it would be that we have these elements that we can hold on to and remind ourselves that we are a part of something greater, that we are connected with the Lord who has freely given us that opportunity, and we are connected with one another, not as a social group, but as a family because of what Christ did on the cross. Paul is very sincere in the book of Corinthians when he writes about this and the importance of this moment in the life of the church and what it is that we are doing when we take communion together. And this morning, just to keep that in mind before we take communion, I want to read this. And I want to just make sure that you understand that in order to take communion here at Gitmo 1100 Church, you don't have to be a part of a specific denomination. You don't have to come from a specific background. When you take the bread and the cup, what you are declaring is that I believe in the work that Jesus Christ did on that cross, and I have claimed that for myself. I have received his forgiveness. And when we come up and take the bread and take the cup, we are doing that very thing. And I understand that some of us may come from backgrounds that have a few more things put on that. And as we continue to work out this journey and that certainly understand and respect that. But here we want to make sure that regardless of that, we believe that it is simply that. If you claim the cross, then regardless of your background, this communion table is open to you this morning. Paul says, "For I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread and he gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it into pieces and he said, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again.'" And then he gives this warning. "So anyone who eats this bread and drinks this cup of the Lord unworthily is guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. That is why you should examine yourself before eating the bread and drinking the cup." And this is where it gets a little sticky. And I understand that some have worked that out and said, okay, then it has to be this and this, this. But here is what we understand that taking it in an unworthy manner to mean. It means simply going through the motions and not taking the opportunity to allow the Holy Spirit to do some work on our heart this morning. To understand that this is a very sacred moment. It is the bread that represents his body and it is the cup that represents his blood. And as we hold these elements, we have an opportunity to let the Holy Spirit do some business in our hearts. And so what it means to take communion in a worthy manner, it means that you and I are opening ourselves to the Holy Spirit's presence right at this moment. That as we hold these elements, we will give the Holy Spirit free access to examine us and then speak into our mind. And our commitment is that we will listen. That is what it means to take communion in a worthy manner. So with that in mind, I would love to pray for this, and then the guys are going to come and open the communion trays. The way we take communion here, we're going to invite you to come down the center aisle, and for the first time, you do not have to put on your mask. You can just simply come down. You can take the bread, take the cup, and then go around the outside back to your seats. And we just ask that you would hold on to those elements. Once we've all received the elements and moved back to our seats, as we sing this next song, this is the opportunity, this is the moment to have that interaction as you hold on to those elements that are so important visuals for us to be reminded of what this means. And then after we've all come and taken the elements and moved back to our seats and we finish the song, we will then all take communion together as one family, okay? Father, thank you for these moments ahead. We don't take them for granted. We are grateful that you have given us this opportunity to remember who we are in you and to remember who we are in one another. And so, Lord, right now we invite your Holy Spirit to examine us deeply, to get into our secret places, and to speak to our hearts and our minds. And our commitment is that we are listening. Thank you for this very sacred moment. In the name of Jesus, amen. Come and take communion.
King
we mention this as often as we can, that it was certainly, it was on the night that Jesus was betrayed that he chose to have this moment with his disciples. And I think the importance of that was to remind us that there are going to be times where we come up short, and that will never mean that we are not allowed this communion moment, this interaction with the Lord, because of the forgiveness of that cross. And so we hold on to that truth. And at that table, Jesus took the bread and he broke it, and he said, "Take and eat this. This is my body given for you. Let's take together." And then later he took the cup and he said, "This represents my blood, which will be shed for you." This is the payment. They had always known that there was a blood payment required for sinfulness. And that was the moment where he declared, "This would be the once and for all payment for your sinfulness." Let's take a reminder of that. Lord Jesus, we praise you for freely giving us what we could never possibly earn on our own. Thank you for thinking of us. Thank you for making the movement, Lord. We celebrate this season of your incarnation, of you choosing to come to live among us so that you could do this incredible act of forgiveness and payment for us. We do not take it lightly. We do not take it for granted. We give you praise and honor in this moment. In the name of Jesus, we pray together. Amen. Fantastic. Amen. Thank you. Well, at this moment, I would love to dismiss all of our children who are in the four-year-old up through fourth grade category to meet your teachers in the back of the classroom, where they will walk you safely across the parking lot to be a part of a great morning, great things that are going on over there. And before I share with you a few announcements, we have a really special guest this morning. I would love to invite up for just a brief moment Captain Darren Stinnett, who is a chaplain, Stinnett, who is our region chaplain. He is the part of the office that makes sure we are taken care of and that we have an effective chapel ministry here. So, Chaplain Stinnett, thank you for taking what we all know is not a very easy trip down here to visit us. And so thanks for being with us this morning.
Well, Bill, I just wanted to take a brief moment and thank you for your hospitality. It's been so great since I got here. Bill said, when you get here, we're going to take you on a boat ride. We've got a parade set up to welcome you. That was pretty exciting. I had never had that before, so that was great. Thank you for that. And then this morning, such a great opportunity to celebrate Advent with you as we look at anticipating Christ's coming and return, as we prepare our hearts for this Christmas season, and we long to see what Jesus wants to do in our lives. This Advent season reminds us of that. So thank you for what you've done here. We very rarely in the chaplain corps, such a nice moment. Yeah.
It doesn't last long.
We very rarely in the chaplain corps get a first tour chaplain like Chaplain Wickham. He came with many, many years of ministry experience to us. You guys have been the benefits of that here. So, Bill, I want to thank you for your faithfulness. I want to welcome you to our chaplain corps. COVID has taken and not allowed me to do that much sooner. So welcome you to our chaplain corps team. Welcome your family to our chaplain corps team. And I look forward to worshiping with you the rest of the morning. So God bless you, and thank you for having us today.
Very good. Thank you, sir. Fantastic. Hopefully when you came in this morning, you got a bulletin. And this is a time of year where these bulletins are important because information is coming fast and furious. There's lots of great events going on, of course, base-wide, but even for the chapel. There is a couple things I want to point out if you have not been made aware of, is that we have tonight, we have a marriage enrichment seminar over at Bayview, and we actually have about three more spots available for that. So if you have somehow missed that and you're like, man, I want to be a part of that, or I wanted to be a part of that, you just need to grab me after service today and let me know, and we will make sure and get your name on that. And then there is also, and there's information in your bulletin, a leadership seminar tomorrow. So we're blessed. Chaplain Sennett came down with Senior Chief Clarador, who is his senior chief that is a part of that team, as well as Chaplain Whiting, who is the Credo chaplain, and he presents some incredible seminars. He did yesterday, I want to call it start, but Safe Talk seminar on suicide awareness. It was phenomenal. And then tonight will be the marriage enrichment, and tomorrow the leadership. So all of those things are out there. There's a little bit of information in your bulletin about that. Last thing, I want to make you aware of some of the Christmas goings-ons that are coming up for our Gitmo 1100 service. Well, base-wide is the Christmas concert, which you may know as the Christmas cantata, but there will be representatives of all our different Christian faith groups on base that will be doing a couple songs. We'll be doing the Christmas story. That'll be out at the Lyceum on the 18th at 6 o'clock at night. Then we have our Christmas Eve candlelight service, which will happen here also at 6 o'clock and in the evening. And then on the 22nd, the Sunday after Christmas, we will not be meeting in here. We will be meeting down at Windmill Beach at 9 in the morning at 0900, and we'll be doing a service day. We'll be cleaning the beach, and breakfast will be provided that morning at the beach, and we are encouraging everyone to bring a lawn chair for that. But it won't be a regular service per se. We'll do some worship, but it'll just be more us serving the Gitmo community as just a way of giving back as we get ready to launch into the new year. So very much looking forward to that. Well, with that, I would love to just turn your attention to this video for just a moment.
God had been silent for 400 years. We knew because we were listening, in a sense. My job is to listen. You wouldn't call a person that talks a lot a wise man, would you? No, you'd call them many, many, many things, but a wise man wouldn't be one of them. My position is to look for signs everywhere. A star, for example. I can look at a star and watch it and wait and see what the star is trying to tell us. I read one time of a star that would announce a new king. And then one day, there it was, a beacon in the night, a star like, unlike any other star I'd ever seen before. And so I followed it. Several of us, we followed this star. It was bizarre. The star would lead, it would move, and we would follow. Our journey took 2 years, and it led us to Judea. And then the star stopped. It just stopped. Shining down over this small cottage, our journey ended not at a palace for a king, but at a home for a peasant. This was it. I mean, we gathered our thoughts, we gathered our gifts, we did all that we could do to contain our emotion. And behind those doors was a new king. A king that could command the stars in the sky and yet chose to dwell among us. A king that spoke and the word became flesh. God was finished being silent. That night, we knelt. We bowed down before this baby boy. And each one of us laid gifts at his feet. We had to, we couldn't help it. 400 years of silence, broken by the cries of the Son of God.
Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 says, Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. Verse 19 says, For God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ, and through him God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. Folks, Christmas is a celebration of God's choice to be with us, and that choice changes everything. That choice is worthy of our celebration, it is worthy of our attention, and it is the greatest event in all of human history. As we mentioned last week, however, that choice brings with it a handful of incredible and amazing gifts to you and I. So he doesn't just come empty-handed. Because he chose to come and live among us in the flesh, we receive some gifts from that. Last week, we pointed out as the first Sunday of Advent that one of the things that this gift brings us is the gift of community. And we talked about that and wrestled with that, what that sense of community looks like. It's what we just experienced at the communion table. But the second gift that we receive as a part of this great gift of him choosing to be among us is that when God chose to be with us, he gave us the gift of knowledge by revealing himself. Now, I know that might not seem quite as catchy as gift of community, just the gift of knowledge, but literally this choice to reveal himself, this God who is a mystery and will always be a mystery until we are standing in his throne room in heaven, chose to reveal so much of himself in this Christmas story, in this reality of coming in the flesh, and we learn so much through that. The reality is, in the New Testament, the Christmas story is told through so many lenses. Now, I'm excited on Christmas Eve. Our Christmas Eve candlelight service is going to be a joint service with the JTF chaplains, and we are each going to take a different lens. We're going to look at Christmas through the lens of the shepherds, look at Christmas through the lens of the wise men, look at Christmas through the gift of those key players that were a part of that, even the innkeeper. And to really tackle Christmas from, there's so many angles at it. But one that we want to look at this morning is specifically the wise men and Christmas through their eyes, as we just saw in this video. And to do that, I would love to open up by reading the story straight out of Matthew chapter 2. And I'd love to read these verses, and then we'll just tackle what that means for us right now. It says, Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the reign of King Herod. About that time, some wise men from eastern lands arrived in Jerusalem asking, "Where is the newborn king of the Jews? We saw his star as it rose, and we have come to worship him." King Herod was deeply disturbed when he heard this, as was everyone in Jerusalem. He called a meeting of the leading priests and teachers of the religious law and asked, "Where is the Messiah supposed to be born?" "In Bethlehem, in Judea," they said, "for this is what the prophet wrote. And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not least among the ruling cities of Judah. For a ruler will come from you who will be the shepherd for my people Israel." Then Herod called for a private meeting with the wise men, and he learned from them the time when the star first appeared. Then he told them, "Go to Bethlehem and search carefully for this child. And when you find him, come back and tell me so that I can go and worship him too." After this interview, the wise men went their way, and the star they had seen in the east guided them to Bethlehem. It went ahead of them, and it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They entered the house, and they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down, and they worshipped him. Then they opened their treasure chests, and they gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And when it was time to leave, they returned to their own country by another route, for God had warned them in a dream not to return to Herod. So we learned some things from these magi, from these wise men. And first of all, in case you're kind of circling around this, and obviously this is not a new story. If you've been around church, you have circled around these guys for a long time. But this is a weird story. These are weird characters when you think about who the church is, certainly the Jewish leadership, who the church had always been for so many years. Suddenly there are these players that are not the typical players coming into scene here. But we learn some things from them. And the first thing we learn is that God does whatever it takes to draw people to himself. The Bible is filled with extreme examples of God reaching across the aisle and drawing in those who were not really a part of the in crowd, who were not a part of the typical church crowd. Certainly when Jesus encountered the woman at the well, that was a shocking moment of reaching across and making sure that there was this exclamation that this is now accessible to everybody. When he touched the leper, there was a great point in that. When non-Jews were interacted with who they weren't supposed to be and they were physically touched, when the despised Samaritans were given a key part in the story, when these lowly, sketchy shepherds were given a glimpse on the night that Jesus was born, that was huge and significant. And then when these really astrologers from Eastern lands were brought into this greatest story ever told, there is something significant about that. So just to talk about these magi for a minute, the Greek word is magos, all right? And this word magos, Strong Concordance translates magos as a magician or an oriental astrologer. These were weird guys. These were not your typical Bible characters. We draw them and they're part of our Christmas story and they look regal, but they were funky, different, out of the norm. This was not, they were just odd people to be in the midst of this. We know that astrology, this whole thing, this was not a positive thing for the church at that time. Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 2 says, "Do not act like other nations who try to read their future in the stars." I mean, God has mocked this practice in the Old Testament. And so my question is, who the heck invited a magician or some Eastern astrologer into our beautiful Christmas manger scene? And the answer is God. It's God who invited them, very clearly using their kind of funky, odd, stargazing system to draw them to this incredible thing that he was doing. And we just can't overemphasize the importance of that, that he used these people's thing, this practice that was not even approved in the church, to make himself known so that more than just the regular players would be a part of this story is so significant. And we have to reflect and wonder on the extremeness of this story and his actions as we go about taking in all of this Christmas. So it's very important to know that God will do whatever it takes to draw people to himself. Last week we said it as God will do anything short of sin to bring you and I to him. But that's really what's going on here. Second thing, another thing that the wise men teach us is that to experience God, we must be willing to be interrupted and, frankly, inconvenienced. Okay, one thing mentioned in that video is that, and it's a generally accepted truth, is that this was not a, hey, let's take this Sunday afternoon and go to the next town over and find this thing that seems like it's going. This was a 2-year journey. These were very, very committed men. They had seen this thing. They had read about it in their prophecies. They knew that something extreme was going to happen. They saw this thing in the stars. They left their homeland. They went on this very difficult journey to pursue. Their lives were interrupted to experience a bit of God. And that is an important truth for you and I. To experience God, often we have to be willing to be interrupted and to be inconvenienced and it not to be just kind of the way that we thought it would all go down. And what I love, and you probably know this, again, if you've been around church with this significant part of this story, is that naturally the first place these men went was the palace. Their understanding was that this was a king, this was royalty that was being born. So of course, when they saw the star and they got the sense of where it was going, they didn't need the star anymore. They went straight into town, they went straight to the palace and asked, where's the king? Where's this new baby king that has been born? And of course, the palace freaks out because they didn't know anything about this. Everyone's trying to figure out. King Herod is instantly threatened. He's worried about what this means for his own longevity. And all of this chaos ensues because what they thought they were going to encounter was something completely different. It's significant to also know that once they realized that this star they were following was not leading them to the palace, and they went out and they continued in their journey, the area that they went to, this was not the great part of town. This was the slums of town. It was the where the lowly were. And again, these seemed to be people of means, and yet they continued to pursue this even though it wasn't. And they pressed on to Bethlehem, and they arrived in this thing even though so many things had gone wrong towards the end of their trip. I've shared with you before, we did a lot of years of youth ministry, and because of that, that all the years that we pastored in Northern California, we continue to stay very involved in our youth group. And one of the things that we did every year is we would take a whole bunch of teenagers down to Mexico. Obviously from California, that's a little easier done. We go to Mexico to do some sort of missions trip. And that usually happened, our big trip every year was at Easter. And we would take many weeks to prepare for these trips. And like clockwork, as the trip started to approach, something insane would fall apart. Some sort of chaos would happen. Some huge inconvenience would arise. And I, as the great spiritual leader of the church, would absolutely begin to freak out. And then would think, oh my goodness, maybe this is a year we're not supposed to go to Mexico. I don't want to get a kid killed. And sure enough, one of our leaders would pull me aside and remind me that, man, this is where the good stuff's going to happen. And every year we get inconvenienced. Every year something goes haywire. But every year God shows up and I have to be reminded and come back to that place. And sure enough, we step into it and it is always phenomenal and incredible. But usually it took a decision to be willing to be interrupted and inconvenienced. I mean, we didn't even call it Mexico towards the last few years. We call it Flexico, right? Because it just wasn't nothing that we planned. We go down there and all of our plans would be interrupted. But that's where God does some of his greatest stuff. And that's a reality that certainly these wise men learned and are teaching us through their example. Another thing that these magi teach us is that at some point in the journey, we must transition from being a seeker to being a worshiper. At some point, we have to decide it is good to be a seeker. But at some point, we need to move on from being a seeker of things to a worshiper. Let me reread what we read there. Matthew chapter 2, verse 9 through 11. After this interview, the wise men went their way, and the star they had seen in the east guided them to Bethlehem. It went ahead of them, and it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They entered the house, and they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down, and they worshiped him. Then they opened their treasure chest and they gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. So let me just talk briefly about the difference between seekers and worshipers. First of all, sometimes in the church today, you know, there was an era where we were seeker sensitive and we loved the word, but then it kind of got like not such a positive word. But seeker, to be a true seeker, it's a noble thing. And because the reality is that seekers are tenacious. I'm not talking about looky-loos. I'm not talking about, you know, people who have a cynical name. I'm talking about true seekers. And I'm always in awe of those who are not afraid to ask the tough questions and not afraid to sit in the back and just say, I'm listening, but I'm not there yet. And I will let you know when I am there, but I'm going to keep asking the tough questions until I get there. Like a true seeker is tenacious. Obviously, these wise men were seekers. The distance didn't hinder them. The rough journey didn't hinder them. When they showed up at the wrong place, it didn't hinder them. When they showed up to the actual scene where Jesus was and it looked nothing like they pictured when they left their palaces 2 years prior, it didn't hinder them. But what it did do is it convinced them to transition. Now that they had found him, they realized they couldn't continue to be seekers. That was a great start, but now it was time to make a decision, and they chose to be worshipers. And the thing about worshipers is that worshipers will give their very best. And I just need to camp on that for a minute. It doesn't matter whether we're talking about singing. It doesn't matter whether the instruments show up that day. It doesn't matter how well the programmed event is. It doesn't matter how cool the t-shirts are. Worshipers will give their very best to what is going on, regardless of any of those things. It doesn't matter how visible the work is, how many others are going to see what we're doing. If we are in the act of worship, we will give our very best, whether it's a song, whether it's in prayer, whether it's a work of service, whether it's our occupation. And true worshipers don't measure their gifts based on how they feel. because there's a word for that. It's called tipping, okay? After we have good service and we decide we are going to tip a certain amount, that's a great practice. But that's not what worship is. We don't worship based on, well, oh, that was pretty awesome. That was a great service. Now I'm really going to be able to worship. Boy, the band was really on today. I am going to worship. Worship is a decision that is made prior. And we will give our very best regardless of all the other things. And again, worship is not just a music thing. I know I'm using that as an example. Worship is what we do to honor God. And when these wise men showed up and the scene was just crazy and it was less than in so many ways, they didn't go, oh, no, put the expensive stuff back. Hey, I got a shirt that I brought from my homeland. You know, they brought the good stuff out. They laid their very best at the foot of this baby who was in the manger and worshiped him in all that they had. And it should cause us to question, do I give my very best in my worship? And the fourth thing that they teach us, and it's kind of almost as an aside, it's just a tag on at the end, but it's so hugely important, is that we must never stop listening. On this journey, on this following, on this receiving all of these great things of Christmas and all the encounter that we have this practice of receiving the revelation of God and the knowledge that comes with that and the gifts that come with that, we must never stop listening. Verse 12, when it was time to leave, they returned to their own country by another route, for God had warned them in a dream not to return to Herod. I mean, I know myself enough to know. Found baby, check. Worship happened, check. Gifts delivered, check. Time to go home, boys. Let's go. You know, like, and just in motion, like the journey's over, the mission's over. Like, let's go, let's just go back. Okay, let's go back. But these guys were able to stay in a place of listening to the Lord because obviously it says, and in a dream, in the midst of all this, between the time they left the palace to when they found the baby Jesus to when they decided it's time to head home, they heard from the Lord, and he said, don't go back to Herod. That's not good. That's not what I have. Just go home quietly. And that is a great challenge in the midst of all these things, that sometimes in the midst of all this greatness, in the midst of experiencing God, in the midst of receiving all that we get at this Christmas time, we can't stop listening after the big event, after whatever it is that God has chosen to do in our lives. We have to keep our eye on the ball. I don't know if you remember how many of you got pegged with the test, the quiz when you were kids at school. You remember the quiz that the teacher was very clear, I'm about to give you a quiz, and some of you teachers have probably done this. Do not do anything until you read all the instructions, and they laid it in front of you. And then the instructions were very clear. Do nothing until you read all these instructions. Then like the first instruction, put name in the top left corner, second instruction, da-da-da, third, you know, circle all the cities named on this document. And then the very last one that said, do nothing. Put your pin down, your test is over. And you failed, right? Because you like instantly the moment put, oh, I can do that. And da, 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 and got working at it. And it's embarrassing if you failed it like the next year when the next teacher gave it and you should have remembered. So, but sometimes we get so into the just go, go, go that we stop listening, we stop paying attention. And that's the reality in our walk as well. Because we just want to get to it. And it's very difficult at times to keep on listening through the journey. But let me just close by saying God has chosen to be with us. And in doing so, he has revealed himself in a way that we can understand him better. And that understanding or that knowledge helps us. It helps us to do whatever, you know, to remember that he will do whatever it takes to draw people to himself. And sometimes that's using you and I. Sometimes that's revealing himself in a crazy way. It reminds us that we must be willing to be interrupted and inconvenienced. It reminds us that at some point in the journey, we must transition from seekers to worshipers. And it reminds us that we can never stop listening. Father, Lord, we are so excited for this season and then the opportunity it gives us to be reminded of all that you have done and the gifts that it brings us. And Lord, we choose to not go through another Christmas season and be unchanged by it. Lord, we celebrate it and all the lights and all the fun and all the merriment, but we choose to not miss the story and the significance for us and our families in this world that you have placed us in. And Lord, we will receive all of the Christmas story this year. We will let it challenge us and we will let it change us. We thank you that you have chosen to reveal yourself to us by coming and taking on human flesh. We give you praise and glory for that. In the name of Jesus, amen. Hey, as I mentioned earlier, some of the things that we get to do as a part of church family today, obviously lighting Advent candle and communion. But I need to be honest with you, one of the things that I get the absolutely most excited about when it comes to church life is baby dedications, okay? And baptizing a baby into their parents' faith and the act of really understanding that this family has decided they are going to raise this child up in a very significant way. I would love to invite right now the Osborne family to come up here on stage and join us. And we as a church, and this is one of those things we talk about, that there are things that we do, and I'm trying to figure out how to not block us, that we get to do as a church that are great celebrations, but also responsibilities. And, you know, when we do a baptism out at the ocean, we talk about this, that is a responsibility of us as a church, that when we come together, we get to celebrate in these significant moments. So we're going to come up here. I'm going to try very hard not to destroy Jeremy's guitar as we do this. And I'm going to move his very tall music stand. Yeah, this is perfect. This is great. Hi. So I just want to explain again what this very important dedication is that this family, Aaron and Justin Osborne, have decided that they want to dedicate their children into this faith, basically declaring to us and to the Lord that they are going to do whatever it takes to raise them in a way that these two beautiful girls can come to know a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. As I said, there's very few things that get me as excited as that, as parents who are willing to make that kind of a commitment. And so we celebrate that. So we're going to do that in somewhat of a formal way, in that what I'm going to do is I'm going to read you a challenge of what it is that you are really doing here today. And then and you're going to answer with a very specific, we do, God being our helper. And then, Justin, I'm going to ask your parents if they support you in this, and I'm going to ask you all some specific questions. And then I'm going to turn and ask you all as the church, because we are the family that rallies around a family making significant decisions, and then you all will choose to answer as well. So with that being said, and I've gotten over many years, I got over it a long time ago, I will be upstaged by the babies every time, and I'm good with that and 100%. So whatever happens up here, it happens. But Justin and Aaron, you have brought Riley and Madeline before us today, thereby testifying to your own commitment of faith in Jesus Christ and to the faith that God is even now at work in their lives. As they are now presented by you, it will be your duty as parents to continue to teach these two girls about Jesus Christ and what he has done for all of us. In order to testify to your faith and to your desire to nurture Riley and Madeline with this faith, please respond to these questions. Do you promise with the help of God to bring Riley and Madeline up in the instruction and the ways of the Lord, to pray with and for them, and to make every effort to so order your own lives that you will not cause them to stumble? And do you intend to encourage them as soon as possible that each of them will, as soon as each of them will fully understand its meaning, to personally acknowledge their own faith in the Lord Jesus Christ? And if so, your response is, we do, God being our helper.
We do, God being our helper.
Fantastic. All right. And then to Justin's parents, I'm going to step up here. And I'm so sorry. I was going to move the cross, but I thought we probably shouldn't do that because I don't know if we're allowed to. Yeah, no. So will you stand behind Justin and Aaron's decision to raise Riley and Madeline in this way? Will you commit to never hinder in any way their desire to raise these girls in the ways of the Lord and to hold them accountable to the decisions that they're making today? If so, your response is, we do, God being our helper.
We do, God being our helper.
That's awesome. All right. So church, would you all stand? And literally, if you're not comfortable, you don't have to respond. But those who are, as the church family, I'm going to ask you to stand behind this family and to support them whenever possible through accountability and encouragement, and to aid them in this endeavor to raise Riley and Madeline up in the ways of the Lord. And if you are willing to be a part of that journey, to pray and support them right now just in being a part of this, as well as just encouraging them in the days to come, your response is, we do, God being our helper. We do, God being our helper. Mark chapter 10, verse 13 says, people were bringing little children to Jesus to have him touch them, but the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. He said, let the children come to me and do not hinder them from the kingdom of God, for it belongs to such as these. I tell you the truth, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. And he took the children in his arms and he put his hands on them and he blessed them. And so with that, Justin, if you would be willing to bring Riley over here, and your choice, keep her, and I'll just do this. I'm going to pray right now, and I'm going to, hi, Riley. I'm just going to do a little drop of, I'm going to pray this. Riley, on behalf of your parents and these here today who support them, I dedicate you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And then let me see Madeline, and then we'll pray for them both together. And Madeline, Emily Osborne, on behalf of your parents and those here today, I dedicate you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Lord Jesus, we thank you for these two girls. We thank you for Riley, and we thank you for Madeline. We thank you for Justin and Aaron and their decision to raise them in this way. Lord, we know that their parents support them, and we as their church family, we support them. We stand behind them, and we honor their decision. Would you continue to bless them as parents, bless them as a family, reveal yourself to them in new ways every day. In the name of Jesus, we all pray together. Amen. Amen. All right. Would you give them a hand? Fantastic. All right. Good job. All right, guys. Wonderful. All right, bless you guys. You're very welcome. All right. Well, it's wonderful that you are standing, and it's appropriate that at this point, let's just close with one final song of celebration, and then we will be dismissed. But just thank you for being a part of this. Again, we love to be the church together. And we love to worship together and experience significant life moments together. And that's what we get to do as a church. So that's certainly worthy of celebrating. So let's do that together.
Amen, church. If God is with us and God is for us, who can be against us? Amen. Let's sing together, Our God.
Stronger God, you are higher than any other.
God, you are higher than any other. And our God is healer, awesome in power. God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand again? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand again? What can stand again? God is greater, and our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. If our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is with us, could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand again? Then what could stand again? Oh, God, who is greater, and our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. God, God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God.
Amen. Hallelujah. Give him some praise.
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. God, thank you for your great love for us, that you're an awesome God, that you love us, God, regardless when we make mistakes, when we sin, when we fall short. And you love us, God, when we're on a mountaintop, when we're listening to you, when we're doing what you're calling us to do, Lord, that you remind us, God, that you're always with us, that you love us. This season, Lord, we would just bring the hope of Christ to someone, our neighbor, our family, a friend, and show them that they're loved by God and that we would just be continue to live out who you're calling us to be. We ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You're dismissed. Have a great day.